Welcome back to Scale Me Down and to part three of the series where we're building and reviewing this VQ Models de Havilland Twin Otter. In the last episode, we got it flying really nice, after a bit of a false start that is, but in this video, we're going to design and scratch build some floats to fit. Please remember to like and subscribe to support the channel. Let's get cracking. I started from these notes written by Chuck Cunningham in RCM many years ago. They outline the overall size, the position of the step, the angle of the planing surface, and many other important details. I used all this information to design some custom floats in Inkscape so that we could then laser cut all the bulkheads accurately. Most were cut from medium 3/32 balsa, although the highly stressed ones were cut from 3mm light ply. I made some templates for the float sides by printing the drawing out and then taping together the individual A4 printed sheets. I stacked four sheets of 3/32 medium balsa together so that I could cut all four float sides out together on the bandsaw. I designed the bulkheads with a hole that fits a nice straight piece of 22mm copper pipe. This ensured dead true construction. I then fitted these 3/16 square section longerons with little dabs of CA glue, checking each frame for square as I went. I used a razor plane to chamfer the longerons to match the bulkheads. I could then add the float sides using aliphatic glue and little dabs of CA to hold the parts while the aliphatic cured. The mandrel helped to keep the floats dead straight whilst I drew in the bow and the stern. That is the basic structure of both floats all made. Once this one is cured, I can go ahead and remove this copper pipe mandrel before installing the last bulkhead. And then before we sheet in the tops and bottoms with cross grain 3/32 balsa sheeting, we'll install the blocks for mounting them, the internal push rod, and the mount for the water rudder. If you've never done any traditional scratch building before, you really should try it. It's very satisfying. And the addition of a razor plane, as you saw there, for chamfering these longerons, for example, saves an awful lot of the mess and dust. And it does produce these lovely, soft, fluffy shavings. Anyway, on with the build. Whilst access is easy, I installed these plywood mounts for the water rudder servos and these boxes to accept the cross struts. The float bottoms need to be super strong, so I sheeted them cross grain, again with 3/32 balsa. I left the sheets overhanging, and then when they're all cured, I trimmed and sanded them back. Building the floats was similar to building a pair of fuselages. However, unlike a fuselage, I had to treat the insides with sanding sealer to waterproof them just in case. Next were the servos and push rods for the water rudders. Then, in case water ever does get in, I made these door rebates into the top sheeting on our laser. Now another sheeting time lapse before we glue the nose blocks into position using epoxy and a little dab of CA. The razor plane and a power file made shaping these blocks quick and easy. I then covered the floats in 20g per square metre fibreglass and G4 resin. Ironically, the first time the floats got wet was during the priming and wet sanding process.
That is the main construction of the floats completed, and it took a couple of passes of primer and wet sanding to get to this stage. And now it's time to join them. And this is where we're going to use those ply boxes that we made earlier, and that's where these holes lead to. And then to join the floats, we're going to use this 6mm carbon rod, which will be fitted inside this airfoil section aluminium tubing. And that will then epoxy into the sockets thus. And we'll lay the floats up upside down on the bench to make sure they're in perfect alignment and perfectly parallel. With the floats assembled together as a pair, with all the cross struts now glued and cured, we can move on to mounting them onto the aircraft. And here I've used these little plastic brackets from Sleck over the main gear axles, and they're screwed into the plywood mounts that we installed earlier. However, before we make up the front struts, it's important that we can confirm the angle of incidence as we mount them. That will affect the length of the front struts. And to do that, here I'm going to use this digital inclinometer. The angle of incidence when measured from the cord in relation to the top of the floats should be around half a degree. To achieve this, I made the front struts from some flat aluminium bar from a local hardware store. This was cut, filed, drilled, and bent to suit. Next were the water rudders, and I made these using some brass strip, tube and collets from our local model shop. I cut the rudders from this G10 fiberglass board, and you can see that my saw blades hate it. To mount them, I drew and 3D printed these simple brackets. The servo and pushrod are hidden inside the float, and the rudder is designed to hinge up out the way in case it hits anything. The floats are all done and all painted, and we've come down to our local canal to test them for buoyancy. So far, so good. It floats, and it actually sits quite high in the water. The water rudders seem quite effective, and of course we can switch them off at the transmitter mix for takeoff. Let's try a high-speed run. It planes nicely, and the reverse thrust is pretty effective. I'm really happy how these floats turn out, and the scratch-built ones offer some advantages over the VQ set. Well, that was a successful test, but we've run out of time in this episode. So join us next time where we'll try a flight with the floats on and see how they affect the flight performance. Thanks for watching.